Hi, I'm Matt from Haltech, and today on Technically Speaking, I'm going to show you how crank sensors work and how to set up any crank sensor type on an Elite Series ECU. Today, we're going to delve into one of the most important but often confusing areas of setting up your ECU, the crank and cam sensor setup page. The crank and cam sensors are without a doubt the most important sensors on any engine. Without these sensors, there's no way for the EFI system to determine either engine speed or engine position. And without knowing engine speed or position, the ECU simply can't run the engine properly. There are two components to the crank and cam sensor setup. There is the sensor itself and the toothed wheel that triggers the sensor. Now, broadly speaking, there's two different types of sensor: analog and digital. And there's countless different sorts of trigger patterns that different engine manufacturers use. Within the ESP software, both the sensor type and the trigger wheel pattern need to be programmed so that the ECU can know the type of sensor you're using and the pattern of the crank signal to expect. We find the crank and cam sensor setup page by going into the setup menu in the main setup page on the trigger setup tab. The simplest way to let the ECU know what crank pattern to expect is to select your engine type in the trigger type drop-down box. Most of your common engine types will be found here. However, if your particular engine type is not listed here, you do have the option of setting up a generic sensor type. Within the generic sensor types, you can select a standard trigger type, which means one tooth per cylinder. And this is common on distributor applications where there's a crank sensor pickup built into the distributor. We also have a generic multi-tooth options. These crank sensor patterns are all evenly spaced teeth. So if you had a crank pulley with, say, 12 evenly spaced teeth, you could select generic multi-tooth trigger type, enter 12 in the number of teeth, and select the sensor location as on the crank. Now, one thing to note with the generic multi-tooth application is because all the teeth are evenly spaced, the ECU can determine engine speed, but not engine position from this sensor alone. So a home or cam position input is also required to determine the discrete position of each tooth on the crank sensor. The last of the generic sensor types that can be selected is the generic missing tooth pattern. These crank pulleys are a lot like the multi-tooth trigger types, but they have a spot on the wheel that looks like it should have teeth in it, but they've been removed, hence the name missing tooth. The ECU can use the missing tooth location to determine a discrete position on the crankshaft. So when using the generic missing tooth crank sensor type, you also need to enter the number of teeth that should be on the wheel. Now, that's not the actual number of teeth on the wheel. So if you've got a wheel like this one, it should have 60 teeth, but there's two missing. So the number of teeth will be 60 and the number of missing teeth is 2. So now we've told the ECU what pattern to expect from the crank and cam sensors, we need to tell it what sensor type is being used. Now, broadly speaking, there's two types of crank sensors, analog and digital, and the electrical signal that these sensors produce is very different. So let's first take a look at the simpler of the two sensor types, the digital type. Now, these sensors output a digital square wave, which basically means the output is either on or off, depending on whether there is a tooth under the sensor or not. Now, these sensor types will always have a power supply, 5, 8 or 12 volts, a ground, and a signal output. In the trigger setup page, we select the Hall effect sensor type for all digital sensors. Normally, we'll set the trigger pull-up setting to on with these digital sensors as well. The only reason we turn the trigger pull-up off with a digital sensor is if we're installing the Haltech ECU in parallel with a factory ECU, so both ECUs are sharing the input from the crank sensor together. In this case, the factory ECU has its own built-in pull-up, so you switch off the pull-up in the Haltech software. The other sensor type is an analog sensor, or more technically, a variable reluctance transducer. Now, the physical makeup of these sensors is quite simple. They're a permanent magnet that's got one wire that goes in, wraps around the magnet, and comes back out again. So the two pins of a reluctor sensor are actually opposite ends of the same wire that wraps around a magnet. When you swing a ferrous metal past the magnet, the magnetic field is disrupted and an AC voltage is generated. The amplitude and frequency of this AC voltage is based on the speed at which you swing the ferrous material by the sensor. Hooking up an oscilloscope to a reluctor-style sensor, you can see the signal looks very different to that of a digital sensor. And as I increase RPM, you can see how these reluctor-style sensors vary their amplitude with engine speed, which means the ECU needs to do a lot more work when interpreting this style of signal. In fact, these analog signals need to be first converted into digital signals for the ECU to understand them correctly. And for this reason, when you set up the sensor type to reluctor in the trigger setup page, a new map appears in the map programming tree. The ECU uses the settings in this map to convert the analog signal into a digital signal. Whenever the signal crosses the voltage threshold set in the voltage threshold map, the ECU considers this to be the start of the signal. And when the analog signal drops below ground, it considers this to be the end of the signal. Because as we saw on the oscilloscope, the voltage of reluctor sensors varies with RPM, the threshold voltage map is also based on RPM. Once the ECU has been programmed to look for the correct crank signal pattern and the correct sensor type has been selected, the correct signal edge needs to be selected. Now, for every tooth or signal, there's both a rising edge and a falling edge, and they occur exactly one tooth width apart from each other. For most applications, it doesn't really matter which edge you select because it'll be corrected for when you set the TDC offset angle. However, in the case where you have teeth that are not all the same length, like for example the Nissan optical sensor or some Mitsubishi crank sensors, then setting the edge correctly is very important. Now, the filter levels employ different levels of electronic hardware filtering to the crank sensor input to prevent electrical noise and to attenuate for very high amplitude signal voltages. Although, with the voltage threshold map being RPM mappable, it's rare that these filter levels need to be employed. Now, the ground reference is only enabled in situations where one of the two wires from a reluctor sensor is wired into the ECU. This usually only happens in a parallel installation where you've got a factory ECU and a Haltech ECU. And the factory ECU is only looking at one of the two signal wires and it grounds out the other signal wire. So the Haltech ECU is therefore forced into operating on the same basis. And finally, the edge rejection ratio sets a blockout period that the ECU will not look for the next crank tooth based on the proximity of the previous tooth. So this occasionally needs to be employed when sensors start to age and either the crank wheel wears or the sensor itself wears and gets a sort of signal bounce. Basically what happens here is the sensor double triggers immediately after the real signal, causing the ECU to read both the real signal and the signal bounce. Setting the edge rejection ratio to say 20% tells the ECU to ignore any signal that occurs within 20% of the previous tooth, eliminating the issue of sensor bounce. So there you have it, all of the settings on our crank sensor setup page explained. Hopefully this topic has helped shed some light on one of the more complex areas of the software setup. If you've got any further questions, please don't be afraid to reach out to us on any of our channels. Well, I'm Matt from Haltech, and I'll see you next time.